let's bring on the stage our very own Ruth Schwartz.
Thank you, Mel. Are you an admired leader, or are you an arrogant jerk? Now, I promise I'm not going to call you an arrogant jerk from here on the stage today. I don't even think you're an arrogant jerk. But we are going to talk about how bosses and managers want to be admired for the work they do, but they are often perceived, justifiably or not, as arrogant jerks. And I learned this one the hard way. I like to think that my life started in the winter of 1978 when I followed the Sex Pistols to San Francisco. Oh, I know you think that's funny, but I sat on the balcony at Winterland and I looked across the room, a tear rolling down my face. I had found my people. And I moved to San Francisco and I became a part of a very vibrant music scene. And so, at the age of 23, as a part of that scene, I decided to start my own music distribution company. I was full of idealism and values. I brought my own values of inclusion and fairness and transparency. And the scene I was in, we had values too of independence. And the very definition of integrity. Walking your talk. My company was going to be different than any company that I had ever worked for in my life. It was going to be a company that I wanted to work for. Now, it took about a year before I hired my first employee. And Tommy and I worked together for 16 years. The first few, we worked just the two of us side by side, slogging it out in the trenches, making it happen. And somewhere around the beginning of that second year, I remember the day Tommy walked to the door. He looked back at me and he said, "I quit." And he left. And I was shocked. I was surprised. I looked around that warehouse right then. I had records stacked up everywhere. I had tons of work. And so what did I do? I ran to his house. And I knocked on his door like a bad girlfriend. "You can't leave me. I can't live without you." And he finally opened the door. He let me in. And he let me have it. Arrogant jerk would have been the nicest thing he said to me on that day. Oh, I did it all. I looked over his shoulder, I micromanaged him, I told him what to do, I undid every decision he made, I undid all things, I never listened to him, and honestly, I wasn't really nice. And I sat there listening to him, totally humiliated. I wasn't walking my talk. This isn't who I wanted to be. Where did I get all of this stuff from? Doesn't it make sense that we need to do something different? So I did convince Tommy to come back to work, but only under the agreement that we would build systems in that business that eliminated the possibility of arrogant jerkdom forever. And that's what we did. We flattened the company. We brought in consensus decision making. We opened the books for full transparency. We created profit shares. We created a whole different company. And it was crazy successful. So now I want to hear from you. What's your experience with bosses, managers, with being a boss or a manager? So let's do a quick straw poll. By a show of hands, how many of you have ever had a job you did not want to go to and you wanted to quit? Yeah, keep your hand up there just for a second. Use the other one if necessary. How many of you felt that way because of a boss or a manager? Thank you. If you see what I see right now, I think it's shameful. I'm ready to see a world where all of those bad habits and all those soul-sucking jobs go away. And they are replaced with soulful jobs. Jobs where people feel they are contributing partners to the organizations they work for. People who are compensated not for time served, like we're in prison, but we're compensated for our contribution to the results. How would you feel if I gave you three habits right now that we could change into something else that would help every one of us, whether we are a boss or a manager, or whether we know a boss or a manager, to start a workplace renaissance? How would that be? Here's number one. Stop managing. What, you say? All right, other show of hands. How many of you want to be managed? Okay, truth be known, I have never walked in a room where people jumped up and said, woohoo, manage me. And I also know all the little voices going in your head. Oh, Ruth, you don't know the people I work with. They need to be managed. People need a lot of things. They need feedback. They need help. They need support. They need training, resources, all kinds of things. But we don't need to be managed. So you have absolute permission from me right now to stop it. And in its place, think leader. Well, what's the difference between a leader and a manager? Without being trite, a leader sees the big vision. They see all the parts. But most importantly, remember this. If there's one thing to remember, it's this. Leaders make other people successful. That's why people follow them. Habit number two. Let's break the delegation habit once and for all. What does delegation really mean? It means that I've got a bunch of problems, and I've got a bunch of work, and I've got a whole bunch of decisions to make, and it's all piled up on my desk, and if you could just come and do some of that for me, everything would go swimmingly. But it doesn't. It doesn't usually work on either side of that equation. So rather than think of delegation, let's think about communication. Well, what's that mean? Sure, one-on-one communication, small group communication, big group communication, yes. But the kind of communication that creates weigh-in instead of buy-in. Think weigh-in instead of buy-in. Think about helping other people solve problems instead of solving them yourself. Think of everybody making decisions instead of being the decider. Number third habit. Stop motivating people. Oh my gosh, here I am. You think I'm motivating you. No, stop it. This is the old adage. You can lead a horse to water, but you cannot motivate them to drink. So don't try it anymore. Motivation is an inside job. Think about lighting people's inner fire by giving them what they love. When you are doing what you love, you're motivated. I believe it's time to come out of the dark and that we're standing in a moment in history above all other times where we can really create this workplace renaissance, the one where everybody in the planet wakes up and can't wait to go to work because they are valued as a contributor to the result.